Thank you, Reverend Perkins. The next item of business, point of order, Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On a point of order, yesterday the Cabinet Secretary for Education announced several significant updates on this year's school exams on Twitter. And this morning, substantive changes contained within today's COVID-19 statement were leaked to the media, including STV and the BBC, ahead of its delivery in Parliament. This has become common practice for the SNP government this session, and I've raised it with you on numerous occasions. And each time I have you say, and I quote, all significant and substantive announcements should be made to Parliament. Presiding Officer, what steps can now be taken to end this contempt? And what can be done to insist that the Scottish Government respect your good office and the Scottish Parliament?
I thank Mr Kerr for that point of order, and I can advise Mr Kerr that I intend to address this issue before we move to the statement this afternoon. And we'll continue with topical questions. And the first question today is Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an explanation of its decision not to proceed with the sale of Glasgow Prestwick Airport at the present time.
Cabinet Secretary Kate Forbes.
During our period of ownership of Glasgow Prestwick Airport, we've sought to do what's right for the business, the taxpayers and the economy of Ayrshire. Glasgow Prestwick Airport has developed as a specialist airport, carving a niche in a very competitive aviation market, and the annual accounts laid before Parliament in December show that the business continues in a positive direction, with a profit posted for 2020-21. We were pleased that the recent sale process attracted bids from credible investors, and very detailed and extensive work was done by all parties involved. However, following careful consideration of a recommendation by the Prestwick Board, we took the decision not to proceed with the sale at this time. Our intention for Prestwick Airport is still to return it to the private sector at the appropriate time and opportunity, but any decision must be informed by what is right for the long-term success of the business and the contribution it makes to the local economy.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, President. So the Cabinet Secretary has just said the government rejected bids for the airport, one preferred bidder, but it seems more than one bid. So can the Cabinet Secretary confirm reports that two bids received from the preferred bidder for Prestwick, and now that this process is at an end and seems there is no longer a preferred bidder, can she tell us exactly why those bids were rejected by ministers? And also, are reports correct that the second bid was lower than the first bid due to withheld information on the condition of the runway coming to light after the first bid was made? And can the Cabinet Secretary also tell us, before these latest bids were rejected, in the nearly 10 years since the government bought Prestwick, has it received and rejected any other bids for the airport?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for those questions, and I know that there's a lot of interest in this, and I think, Presiding Officer, I'm certainly happy to come back to the Chamber to answer some of these points more fully. Throughout the sale process, there's been speculation about bids and bidders, with a number of companies mentioned. I would stress that much of it has been inaccurate. We will need to continue to respect commercial confidentiality and not comment on the identity of bidders or the substance of the bids, which I hope is something that the member appreciates. And that's hugely important to provide confidence in any future sales process, either with previous bidders or with new bidders. In terms of the substance of his question, I can be very clear that the commercial bids received were assessed against the commercial case and the wider economic case for the region. And it's on the basis of independent advice and following a recommendation by the board, the Prestwick Board, that we decided that the bid did not, at this point in time, represent the value for the taxpayer that we are looking for.
Colin Smith.
President Officer, I would certainly welcome a further opportunity, because that vague answer is simply not good enough. I mean, there is no preferred bidder for Prestwick at the moment, so that the Cabinet Secretary can't hide behind an ongoing confidential process that, frankly, is no longer ongoing. The sale has collapsed. So I would ask her to reconsider her answer to my question and tell us specifically why the bids that were on the table were rejected, and given that there is significant investment needed in Prestwick to give it a sustainable future, and that's no longer going to come from any new owner any time soon, can the Cabinet Secretary tell us exactly where the needed investment for Prestwick will come from, or is it a case, as it seems, that a decade after buying Prestwick, the Scottish Government still has no plan whatsoever for the future of the airport?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, there's a lot of questions in there, and I appreciate you want short answers, but I would like to answer them in detail. In terms of the identity of the bidders, whether there is a live bid or not, we should not and cannot comment on speculation about the identity of bidders. I appreciate there's a desire for more information on the detail of the bids received and rejected, but you know, I think it's hugely important, and I hope all members would understand, that we do need to safeguard the integrity of those commercial discussions, both because we're bound by commercial confidentiality and to avoid undermining any future negotiation with current bidders or previous bidders. I can be clear, as I've already said, that the commercial bids received were considered on the basis of independent advice, not to be adequate right now to secure value for the taxpayer. And any return to the private sector needs to be on the right terms. You know, we need to make sure that we're confident that any sale would not only represent that value for the taxpayer, but also puts the business on a firm footing going forward. The long-term commercial sustainability is important. The business needs to develop and support jobs and the economy. And in the most recent sale process, we were not satisfied on the basis of independent advice that those objectives had been met.
Thank you. I call Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given the importance of the Esher Growthdale investment in South Esher, primarily focused around Prestwick Airport, can the Scottish Government give assurances that any future potential buyer for the airport would be supportive of the Esher Growthdale and the spaceport?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think the member makes a really important point that emphasises the comments that I've already made in terms of the meeting the objectives that we have set. And of course, any potential future buyer would need to take their own decisions about what is right for the business. But we are clear that the Ayrshire Growth Deal does provide significant opportunities locally, not just for Prestwick, but for the wider region. And we need to do all that we can to encourage any future owner to engage with local growth deal partners.
Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. Colin Smith tried his best to get an answer to this, but the Cabinet Secretary was having none of it. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary again, what was the reason for the bid or bids being turned down? Was it down to price? Was it down to the price being offered, investment, jobs, or a combination of all three?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I think answering that in a number of different elements, we were pleased that the current sales process attracted a number of attracted significant and credible interest from bidders. We considered those offers very carefully from each bidder, and a revised offer from the business that remained in consideration. We reached the view, informed by the advice of the Prestwick Board and professional advisers, that the sale shouldn't progress further on commercial and broader economic terms. We agree with the Prestwick Board, and this might go some way to answering the members' questions, that the market conditions are not particularly favourable at this time to maximise enterprise value of the business and the value to the Scottish Government as a shareholder. And that conclusion was reached, again, following independent assessment. The business will continue to develop its commercial and its growth strategy under the Scottish Government ownership. And the last point I would make, Presiding Officer, is that obviously the accounts were published in December, and I'm sure they were of great interest to the member. Those annual report and accounts published on the 21st of December show that diverse revenue streams have helped mitigate the COVID impact on passenger numbers in 2020-21. But there's no question that COVID has had an impact on the aviation sector, and an operating profit before exceptional items was £500,000, and the total profit after tax for the year is £12.8 million. So the business is progressing.
In conclusion,
we need to ensure that it's the right bidder at the right time that maximises the economic asset.
Thank you. Question number two, Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it will assist young people to access the expanded free bus travel scheme.
Minister Graham Day.
Presiding Officer, this potentially transformational scheme opened for applications yesterday, and there are a range of ways in which people can apply. These are detailed on the Transport Scotland website. For example, online applications for either a Young Scot National Entitlement Card or a National Entitlement Card can be made at getyournec.scot, the Improvement Services online portal. Applications can also be made directly through local councils. I believe that as of this morning, more than 37,000 applications had been made via the Get Your NEC Scot portal alone. I know there have been some concerns expressed about the complexity of the online process, but the process in place for the Young Person's National Entitlement Card is broadly similar to that for older people, and it's also obviously not ideal to be launching the scheme in the current circumstances. Given the situation with the pandemic, we are encouraging only children and young people whose travel is essential at this time to apply. As I set out in my letter to MSPs last week, I think we are striking the right balance of enabling children, young people and families who potentially have the most to benefit from free bus travel to access it at the earliest opportunity, whilst maintaining plans to fully market the scheme at the right time, potentially helping bus services to recover from the impacts of the pandemic.
Julian Martin.
Thank the Minister for that answer and the fact that he wrote to all of us MSPs and MPs last week to update us on the plans. And I'm certainly going to do what I can to promote the scheme in my constituency. Minister's right, it potentially is a transformational policy. I want to know how the Minister will ensure that children and young people who might benefit the most get their entitlement cards as early as possible. I have had some concerns raised with me from parents applying about the complexity of the application process, particularly on the proof of identity required. Is the Minister concerned that this might limit its success?
Minister Graham Day.
Can I welcome the Member's positive comments about the scheme and her commitment to promote it? But there are no additional proof of age, person or address requirements when applying for a Young Scot NEC with a free bus travel product on it than when applying for one without it. The only difference is that parents, guardians or in some cases carers have to apply on behalf of children and young people under the age of 16 if they want an NEC or Young Scot NEC, which is free, the free bus travel product on it. And they have to provide proof of their status in order to protect the children and young people. But I want to give the reassurance that we are committed to delivering the scheme in a way that's safe for children and young people and instill confidence in parents and guardians, and that we are absolutely determined that the children and young people who might benefit the most from free bus travel don't miss out on it. And we will, of course, be monitoring this scheme and respond accordingly as we go along.
Julian Martin.
Again, I thank the Minister for his reply and what he's just said about monitoring the scheme. I specifically raised this topical question because I did want to ask about one particular group of individuals in terms of the application process. And that's it's been raised to me by foster carers in my area. It's for care experienced and looked after children. And the fact that they might not have ready access to their birth certificates and might have to sort of have that additional process of going to council social work departments for access to them, which might complicate or extend the process for them. And obviously, these children and young people can't be disadvantaged. We need to make sure there's no barriers, additional barriers for them. Can the Minister give some comment on that specifically and how we can make sure that they're not onerous barriers for care experienced young people?
Briefly, Minister.
Joy Martin raises a perfectly valid point. I want to offer her the reassurance that we are aware of the potential challenges for foster care and kinship care families. Clearly, local authorities, which are corporate parents, have responsibility here to help families access this benefit. And we are working with local authorities to ensure that is happening. But I say to members, if there are any issues that emerge involving their constituents, please contact my office and we will seek to assist.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer. The current Young Scot card has already been calculated and is part of the age standard scheme in Scotland. Why can young people not use that until they receive their new cards so they can benefit immediately from the free bus travel?
Minister.
Many existing young Scot card holders are under the age of 16, presiding officer, and therefore need their parent, guardian or carer to apply for a replacement card with the free bus travel product on their behalf. And that's because we're committed to delivering the scheme in a way that's safe for children and young people. For those over the age of 16, local authority partners need to ensure they're sending a replacement card to the correct address, as details held are not necessarily current, hence the need to apply for an additional card. There are also offline Young Scot NEC replacement processes in place with local councils. But again, if Mr Whitfield has any specific cases in mind, he should get in touch with me.
Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. How does the Scottish Government's approach to concessionary and free bus travel differ from that of the UK Government?
Briefly, Minister.
Presiding Officer, there are some very obvious differences. The free national bus travel for the age of 60 and not state pension age would be an example. I think essentially what we have here is a determination to expand national provision of free bus travel, not shrink it insofar as that is possible.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions.